I had the privilege of being co-author with Dr. Kennedy of 13 books, and the latest is How Would Jesus Vote, which is the topic on tonight's program, a Christian perspective on the issues. Now, a lot of people, when they hear that title, they think, what? What do you mean, how would Jesus vote? I remember one time I was doing a radio show, and somebody made the comment on the radio show, well, I know how he would vote. He would vote by parchment, and it would be absentee ballot. But the question itself, of course, is a rhetorical question. It's geared towards making you think, how would Jesus vote? The real question, of course, is how would Jesus have us vote? Then some people ask, well, how can you even say, how would we know how Jesus would have us vote? And our answer to that is the Bible. It's the Word of God. Now, the Bible, of course, is not a political textbook. It's not an economic textbook. But the Bible, of course, says a lot about politics, and it says a lot about economics. And when it does say those things, we need to pay close attention. One time on my radio show, I interviewed Richard Land of the Southern Baptist Organization, and he made a comment that I thought was very memorable. In fact, I thought this is so good, I made sure I put it in the book. He said, you know, I'm not sure if God Almighty necessarily has an opinion on NAFTA or CAFTA, but I am convinced that Jesus Christ does have an opinion on the sanctity of life issue. And that's certainly one issue that means a lot to Christians. What we do in this book, in a nonpartisan way, we try to look beyond the political rhetoric and go into great depth looking at matters of life and death, abortion, stem cells, suicide, euthanasia, crime and punishment. We look at the death penalty, a Christian perspective on that. War, is it ever justified? These are various chapters in the book. Education in our schools, economic concerns, and let's be blunt, too many politicians these days are basically trying to buy votes, and it's disgusting. Healthcare issues, the environment and climate change, immigration, racial prejudice, marriage, society's smallest unit, and judicial activism and the courts. And so we try to look at these things. Now, in this milieu that we find ourselves in, there is an incredible amount of rhetoric, especially geared towards conservative Christians getting involved in the political process. There's a great deal of backlash. For example, Don Fetter, who is an Orthodox Jew, and he wrote a book several years ago called Who's Afraid of the Religious Right? He compiled a list of several recently published anti-religious right books, and we call out the list and just, you know, have them. And when you look at these titles, you realize the incredible backlash. For example, American Fascists, The Christian Right and the War on America. Religion Gone Bad, Hidden Dangers of the Christian Right, Why the Christian Right is Wrong. Another book, The Left Hand of God, Taking Back Our Country from the Religious Right. Theocons, Secular America Under Siege, American Theocracy, The Baptizing of America, The Religious Right's Plan for the Rest of Us. Piety in Politics, The Right-Wing Assault on Religious Freedom, by the Reverend Barry Lynn, who sues you if you try to, in some way, you know, apply the mind of Christ, it seems to me, in the political realm. Kingdom Coming, The Rise of Christian Nationalism by Michelle Goldberg. So it just goes on and on and on, this incredible backlash. But I find it so interesting because I'm a student of American history. And when I look at what the Founding Fathers actually said, I see, to me, it's very, very clear. The Founding Fathers did not want a national denomination. They wanted no established national church at the federal level. That's very, very clear. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. But what today's secularists too often do is they convert those words to mean there should be this strict wall of separation between church and state. The key word here is force. See, what the left is accusing the right of doing, conservative Christians of doing, is trying to force their way on the government. That's not what we want to do. What we want to do is we want Christians to be actively involved, because as George Washington said, what did he say in his farewell address, 1796? This is a very important speech. It was never delivered. It was published in the newspapers. But he said, listen, of all the habits and dispositions which are important to political prosperity, religion and morality are indispensable supports. That's from the father of our country who said that. See, force is the key, but the founders envisioned a vibrant Christianity that would influence our country. Let me close with the words of our second president, one of our great founding fathers, John Adams. He said this, "We have no government armed with power capable of contending with human passions unbridled by morality and religion. Avarice, ambition, revenge, or gallantry would break the strongest cords of our Constitution as a whale goes through a net. Our Constitution was made only for a moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the government of any other." Thank you, and may God bless you, and may God bless America.